And just so you know, right here is where I would have normally shared the last session in the conference. But people in the conference were begging to get out of the ark. They were like ravens. And so I had to release them somewhat. So here's where I normally would have shared coming out of the ark, which is verse 15 through 19. And so those verses, God's called Noah out. They've all left the ark. Now verse 20. And Noah builded an altar unto the Lord and took of every beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And, well, let's go ahead and read the next one. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. Let's just stop right there. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. Reading from my notes here, just as with Noah and his emergence out of the ark, even so we stand on risen ground. In other words, it's kind of a strange thing because getting in the ark represents resurrection, but it's more of an understanding of resurrection out from something. Okay? Out from the old creation. Out from death. Out from, you know, in all of that sense. But coming out of the ark is like a butterfly emerging from a cocoon, which is another form of resurrection. And that is coming into something, being raised up into something, not just out of something. Can you kind of see an emphasis? And those emphases are there in the scriptures. And you can look them up and you'll be reading something. And if it's emphasizing us at a certain juncture, you will know it's relating to resurrection in the ark. If it's reading in another place, for example, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new and all things are of God. That's talking about emerging from the ark into, literally, into the new creation. So, we move forward past death with Christ into living by the life of Christ. But Noah did not just go forth simply to be free, but he entered into a death of another kind that did not include the flood or the ark. And the flood was a death, amen? The ark represented another form of death. But the altar in the new creation represents a whole nother different aspect of death. He discovered that in the new creation, there was an altar also. Noah builded an altar unto the Lord. For the Christian, it involves bearing about in the body his dying by means of his selfless nature. This altar is an altar, it says in Hebrews 13:10, an altar that they have no right to eat of. They have no right to eat of this altar because it is only for those who have passed through the flood and passed through the ark. It's an altar that those who have not made that journey can never eat of. They're too busy dealing with life's problems or their own problems or flesh problems or somebody else's flesh problems. So this involves knowing an altar and a cross that is beyond sin or as a remedy for personal problems. The first act of the first to step on new soil was to raise an altar. That's incredibly significant. The first act of the first person ever to step into the new creation built an altar. But it was an altar raised within the new creation and therefore was no longer a cross for destroying evil. Once full acknowledgement of oneness with Christ in nature has taken place in our lives and we embrace this new altar, then God smells it and is pleased. Because consider death of all flesh. Do you think, consider the flood wiping out all flesh and they're all dead laying there in a heap and they're all been stinking and the ravens been picking at them and everything else. Do you think God's going, oh, this smells really good? this smells good. You know, it represents the cross, but it represents another aspect of the cross. The aspect of the cross that is a sweet savor, folks, is not a sin offering. It is a sweet savor offering. And all of the sweet savor offerings represent Christ in his self-giving nature. It is not related to the old creation. In one sense, it's not related to the new. It's related to the eternal God and how he is in his self-giving nature. Period. Before the foundation of the world. Lamb slain. Not for sin. That had to come later. But he was who he was because this is who he is in his, as I said, in his self-giving nature. The altar was now Noah's way. It was God's way before this. Now it becomes Noah's way. It becomes a way of giving himself. I wrote down it was his tree of life. In the savor and satisfaction of the altar, God said, I will no longer curse. Right then, when this new covenant altar is happening, then he goes, no more curse. Remember? The Lord said that in his heart. From this point on, God only speaks of blessing, but only in light of this altar, and not said in the ark or at the flood. In other words, God never said when he was building the ark, no more curse. He never said in the ark, no more curse. He said when all is dead and Christ is the life and we've come into the new creation of that life in oneness, he says, now there's no more curse. This altar secures the promise as a surety. God does not make random promises, but what is purchased is sure. In other words, God's not just making a random purchase here. Whatever the cross buys, everything. And in this case, the life of Christ is that cross. The nature of Christ is that cross. Not the self-giving nature at the cross for sin, but the Lamb nature in his self-giving way. And folks, that is the new creation. That's why the altar was the first thing there. We would need to mark what this new creation is. He didn't go over and pick fresh fruit, you know, or you know, go do all. His first thing was this altar. This altar, not that altar, not that death over there at the flood. This requires a new altar. And he understood that. After a year with beasts, he went, you know, I know what I am. I can see, I've seen for sure what I am. And there is no hope for any of us if it's not this self-giving Christ. It's just not. There's just not. Somebody gives you something. You don't always take it. Because your way is self-giving. Now, I'm not saying don't tell. I think it's a blessing. I'm trying to point out to you that something, you know, people are willing to go the extra mile or do this or that or whatever. That's fine. That's good that it's in their heart. But it's in your heart. Well, Jesus said, I came not to minister or to be ministered unto, but to minister. And it just gets hard to describe because any description of it, we would put it in a box and make it a certain thing. God has to reveal the new creation in reality, and you will respond. But the revelation of the new creation almost is not valuable, hardly at all, until you've been with your own beast for a good amount of time. Then you will really cherish that altar of self-givingness, because you'll be sick of your own. You'll be sick of beasts. You'll go, you know, there's the thought, you know, it's kind of like this. The whole world was full of beasts back there before the flood. Everything was beasts. I thought neighbor Joe was a nice guy, but he's a beast. You know, you begin to realize that everything but Christ is that way. It's selfish. It's going after what it can get. But Jesus is not. God's response to Noah's altar was no more curse. But remember this, we won't get into that, but I'm just going to mention it here. But Ham ignored that altar of lamb life and rejected the rainbow. Therefore, a curse came upon him. There is a death to the world, a death to us, and there's a death that's simply Jesus in his nature. Noah went through the death represented by the ark, but Jesus alone represents the altar, which is a picture of the new covenant cross of death, meaning this altar is Christ alone. Now that altar has to be put in each of our hearts, becoming the core of who we are, how we are. But it is Jesus. In other words, it's nothing more than another description or a description that God chose to identify Christ as the core structure and manner of the new creation. Okay, let's go to chapter 9 and verse 1. I'm feeling really good. We are moving on, baby. I'm just so happy. Genesis 9. Let's read verse 1. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And then verse 7, and you be ye fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply therein. So the earth is now like a clean slate with all the old writing has been erased off the board. Noah's new responsibility is not involved with beasts, but he's to fill all around him with the seed of Christ. It's a different responsibility. See, God didn't say to him in the ark, be fruitful and multiply. What, more beasts? Is that what we're looking for here? No. Once you've come to the altar of the new creation, he says, be fruitful and multiply and bring forth of the seed of Christ, because everything around you should be filled with this life. Everything around you should be swallowed up of this. God said in Isaiah that the earth was created to be inhabited. Be fruitful, multiply. When he said the earth was created to be inhabited, folks, what that meant was not that the globe was meant to have people on it. That the earth and vessels were meant to have a habitation of God through the Spirit. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Be fruitful and multiply. Bring forth more of your kind. But to be fruitful and multiply will require that new altar to be firmly established inside of us. And that's John 12:24. I think Ben and I were talking about that several weeks ago. John 12:24, you're familiar with it. Except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Folks, that's a picture of the cross. Can I get an amen on that? But you know what? That's not a picture of the death of the old man. That's not a picture of destroying sin. That's not a picture of anything other than how God brings forth fruit. Did you hear what I said? We want to get rid of the old man. Folks, there is an aspect of Christ and the cross that is strictly for fruit bearing. There is a death so that life can come forth, so that fruit can come forth. It's not about getting rid of my problems. It's not about getting rid of my old man. It's not about getting rid of my old fruit. It's about bringing forth his fruit and his life. And so I remember there was the guy who helped create the atom bomb made this statement. Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. And that's actually a quote from the Hindu book, not Bible, but we'd call it the Bible. You know, it's actually a quote from there. But now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. You know what? Jesus on the cross, you could put a big cross right in the big middle of that flood because he was the destroyer of worlds there. He destroyed the Roman world, and he destroyed the Adamic world. He destroyed the Greek and the Jews. He became the death, and as such became the destroyer of worlds. But that's not what John 12:24 is bringing out. In other words, there are many aspects to the cross that we need to see. And this aspect, I believe, John 12:24, relates to the altar in the new covenant. It relates to bringing forth life. Or it relates to bringing forth after kind. It is the way for a Christian to become fruitful. And so, This has absolutely nothing to do with your problems. This is a new creation altar. Now, I have to say, I mean, I probably shouldn't be stopping because we've been making good progress here, but I just have to say that I remember in my early days believing that the way to be fruitful was to go out and win souls, or the way to be fruitful was to build a big ministry, or the way to be fruitful was to do a lot of stuff for God. And many of those that I chose as the way involved no death to me. And I remember when God introduced the thought to me that you haven't even brought forth fruit yet, because I hadn't died in any way. And he's basically saying, well, you hadn't really started yet. And I remember being shocked and hurt. But Lord, I've done so much for you. He said, you've done nothing. Because that's not how you bring forth fruit. And I remember him beginning to work by the Holy Spirit to change my mind, to rearrange my mind. You know, that word transformed by the renewing of your mind is an incredible reality. Transformed? You know, anybody ever see the movie Transformers? This has nothing to do with that. The word transform means metamorphosis, and is the word used for a transformation between a caterpillar and a butterfly. It is the word, the exact word. Transformed into a new creature, and as such, function according to the nature of that new creation. And so in self-giving, life comes out of death. In a seed falling into the ground and die is the secret to a huge harvest of more of his kind. Does that sound good to anybody? More of his kind? An increase of Christ? And I was shook. And God had to start rearranging my thinking and going, you know what, you're going at this all wrong, and you're not making any progress, even though you think you are. And the things that you're calling fruit, I'm calling fooling around. It's kind of like a son that should be over here working for the father, and he's over here fooling around with stuff. Drop that, stop fooling around, and get over here with me, and let's do it the way that your eternal father does it. So, I just felt that, it's just important to understand this whole thing of God's concept. So, this death is not for the destroying of Adam, but for the bringing forth more of Christ as seed and his fruit in us. All right, let's look in verse 2 now. You're still in Genesis 9. I like this verse. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air and upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fish of the sea. into your hand are they delivered. Is that a good verse? My God, this is good news. This is fresh out of the oven. Noah is fresh out of the oven of the ark. And never before has God said, the beasts are going to be fearful of you. Apparently, before this time, man had a fear and dread of the beasts. But now, after the cross, after the altar, well, let's start with after the flood, after the judgment that the ark brings, after the altar and the new creation, now God is ready to change the order of things. And instead of those beasts making you fearful, which is the way it had been all the way in the old creation, now in the new creation, he says, your fear and dread is going to be upon them. Now they're going to freak out over you instead of you freaking out over them, over your beasts and all that stuff. So, increase of the seed and his fruit is our first priority, but to do so results in verse 2, power over beasts. This is good news. That's how you get victory, you know. But folks, here's what we think. We think all this is about is Noah walking down a plank, getting out of the boat, and God saying, now I give you power over beasts. You know, you're the beast master. No. No. Noah had to die in the flood, if you will, and then he had to see why he needed to die in the flood, just like why they needed to die in the flood, by seeing all of his beasts and naming them one by one, calling them what they are, and dealing with them until he's ready to die to himself and accept a new creation altar. That was a pretty big statement then. And if you buy this tape for $7.99, I'm joking. I don't. In other words, these beasts, you're going to keep fearing over them and dreading them. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Beasts that you just, I just dread this. Here they come again. You know? And all the fear that, you know, that they bring and all this kind of stuff, that doesn't change just because God does this. Or that changes because Noah was changed. How was he changed? Again, I made a few statements there that you might not have caught that I didn't emphasize before, and that is I believe that Noah and everything died in the flood or the judgment or at the cross. Everything died at the cross. You agree with that? Okay. Then I believe everything in the sense of judgment died in the flood, including Noah and all them, in the sense that, because remember, a shadow, you know, you put a hand up here and show the shadow of my hand, it doesn't show all the ins and outs of my hands and whatever. It just shows a vague outline. Noah is only a vague outline, so it can't give you the full picture, because how could it kill Noah and save him at the same time? And yet, is that not what God does? He crucifies us and yet saves us at the same time. It's a conundrum. No, there is an answer. And that is that he died in that flood because everybody needed to die. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Not just sinned, but what? Come short of what? The glory of God. That's not sinning. And in that ark, he needed to see why he needed to die. Oh, he already saw the beast in them and knew they needed to die, right? Well, they treat me bad. They said this. They did that to me. My neighbor stole my chicken. You know, I mean, I don't, you know, I'm just, you know. And we're seeing the beast in them and all that. We have to be shut up in that ark, so we'll be shut up before God so that He can release us from the ark into the new creation. And the first thing we want is another nature, another life, an altar. And we're up for it. By then, we're up for it. Hey, I'll have some of that. Whereas before, he was too righteous. Everyone else was messed up. Is not this the common pattern for your life and mine? Yes, it is. God has to bring us down. And so then when you've gone through that, then you become transformed, not conformed to the world, but transformed into God's view and his God's thinking, God's nature. Then and only then do the beasts fear you and dread you instead of you dreading them, because they are confronting Christ, not you. So let me read this again. In the increase of the seed and his fruit is our first priority, but to do so results in verse 2, power over beasts. These are no longer your beasts. Your fear and dread is upon them, and now the beasts fear you because of Christ's life within. When reviled, you revile not. I mean, didn't Jesus say that? And doesn't it say in the scriptures, you know? I mean, I have never, and I think I will never forget the sermon I preached called Forget the Cross and Forget, well, I forget what it was. Yeah, Forget the Lamb and Forget the Cross. Anybody remember that one at all? And I just reduced it down to the fact that the Word of God tells you that if somebody reviles you, you shouldn't revile again. If you're just a Christian, you know. I mean, I think it's a great reality, because someone will say you're a cult because you preach the spirit of the Lamb. So, well, all that is basically doing this scripture and this and this and this. So let's forget the Lamb and forget the cross and just do the Word. Anyway. All right, when reviled, you revile not. You do not respond as they would, as the beast would. When in us, these beast tendencies that once ruled us now fear and dread the one who has gone through the altar. They fear and dread the one who has gone through the altar. They don't fear you in the ark. They don't fear you before the ark. But they fear you after the altar. Why? Because fear of death is no longer a factor in you. You're already dead. In fact, you wanted to die. That's why you embraced that altar in the new creation. I love that altar. You know, and that's why you embraced the flood in reality, the death of all flesh. And you're willing to, you want to embrace it because you see no good thing. What did Paul say? I see no good thing in my flesh. Well, what about this? You know, and that's us before we've gone through the full judgment. Well, what about this? I'm pretty good at this at least. But when we say that, we're going to compare it to somebody who's not good at that, so we're still lifting ourselves up. Every bit of it must die. All right, the beast may rise up in others and crucify Jesus, but he's not governed by those beasts. You know what I'm saying? You know, they said, I probably wrote it down here. He's not governed by them. He would lay down his life instead of being murdered, if that be the case. You have power to call 10,000 angels, but you do not do so. They do not force your hand or rule you. And here's what I mean by that. When you're faced with death, when you're faced with everybody reviling you, when you're faced with people turning on you, when you're faced with people that you have helped and loved and been there for, when they were down and out and they turn on you when you're down and out, you are a son of God and you have the ability to call 10,000 angels. In other words, you have some power in your hand somewhere of some sort that you can lash back with. Amen? Well, I'll just, you know. I'll just do so-and-so. But Jesus didn't do it because he's not ruled by beasts. He's ruled by lamb. He's ruled by altar. He didn't have to. He's just the opposite of me. I would get back at him. He dies for them so that they don't have to die. This is crazy. This is crazy talk. In our realm it is. In his realm, this is normal way of thinking. This is lamb thinking. This is lamb life. All right. Let me make sure Okay, so the beasts are what they are and will still attack and growl at you. Right? Anybody ever had beasts, The devil goes about like a roaring lion. It says that in 1 Peter, right? Chapter 5. The devil goes about, so the beasts are going to growl at you. Somebody said to me once, do you wake up grouchy in the morning? I said, no, I let her sleep. That is just not true. She is the sweetest woman in the world. She is. You know, she always wakes up just, and I'm the grouch. Pardon? Remember that line. You can use it. All right. God did not give us the power of a beastmaster in order to control them, but to not be controlled by them. Now, that's a real powerful statement. We always, the way that most teaching in the charismatic movement is that God gives you power so that you can control the beasts and everyone else, which makes you a beastmaster. No. He makes you a master over your beast. But he doesn't make it where, somebody's going, and growling at you, and, you stupid, and you say, I rebuke that, I bind your tongue now, and they go, But that's what we want. That's the kind of power we want. But if God gives it to you, then he's got to give it to someone else. And you won't be able to talk either. An eye for an eye, everybody's going to walk around blind. So that's ridiculous. All right, fear may be there within us at times, but so is courage. And courage is what? The ability to go on in the face of fear. Courage is not the lack of fear. You would know that if you ever really had it in a real desperate situation. Courage is the ability to go on in the face of fear. Is it what's courageous if you don't have any fear and there's no problem? No big deal. That's stupidity. Because somebody will bayonet you or something, All right, and then it mentioned about not, also in those scriptures about, there's quite a bit there about not drinking blood. And I just wrote this simple two statements. The blood was the life. Don't eat blood except Jesus. In other words, only take in the life of Jesus. That's all it's saying. That's the import of that. Where are we at on our... Wow, we're doing really good. Okay, I'm going to see, because I've got a major section coming up here about the rainbow, and I don't know if I want to get into that. Okay, so God says in verse, see if I can find it. Yeah, Genesis 9:17, and God said unto Noah, this is the token of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth. He just described it there, and he described the rainbow and all of that, and I want to get into that maybe next class. So in relationship to the covenant, it's by grace, because he makes statements here. He says, I will establish my covenant. I will remember my covenant. I will look to this rainbow. this is all grace. This is about him and what he's going to do, not about us and what we have to do. This is not a law covenant. This isn't about what we have to do. This is about what he's determined he's going to do. And I went, well, this is a good covenant. Because this isn't about me and how faithful I am or how good I am or how, you know, astute that I am. So I said, only now can such a covenant be made after all personal hope has been banished by beasts that are still within you or were in you in the ark. You have seen that you are as bad as they were, even though you were a just man and walked with God. Only now is Noah truly ready to receive grace. Now, he found grace in the eyes of the Lord. But to receive grace, folks, you receive grace when you see that you're every bit as bad as anybody else, any other Adamic child. And when you see that, you are ready to embrace grace, not just find it in the eyes of God and go, oh, look, I found grace, and he's going to build an ark and save me because I'm special. If he saved you because you're special, it's not grace. It's grace when you don't deserve it. And that's proof that Noah was as every bit a son of Adam as anyone else. Or why would he need to find grace? You know, I mean, that's almost like a mathematical equation, isn't it? It really makes sense. You know, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. You know, but he was more special and better than everyone else. Yeah, he was a righteous man and all that, but he had the same beast that they did. And man, you've got, you know, there is this facing of the beast, this facing of the dark night of the soul that is horrendous period in your walk. But it is so beneficial down the road. So now, and only now, can such a covenant be made. If God tried to make this covenant before, it wouldn't have meant near as much as it did to him now. What man received from God was not just salvation while still being left in the old creation, which is kind of our version of salvation. We're saved, but we're in the old creation, right? Isn't that sort of many denomination, isn't that the basic denominational teaching of salvation? You're saved, but you're still in the old creation. I got news for you. You've been raised up. You've been brought into something new. Now, just because you don't act like it or think like it doesn't mean anything. You are, as far as God is concerned, brought into this thing, but he cannot fully open the door to it in your understanding until he has revealed all your beasts to you. Oh, fun. Amen? We got such fun facing us. We talked about the pigs and the monkeys. Folks, you haven't even seen the hyenas yet. See, I hear them laughing right back there. Didn't we use this one during the conference? I think so. I think we did. All right. But true grace, I said, great, what man received from God was not just salvation while still being left in the old creation. We call that grace. Saved, but still in the old creation. But true grace brought man to a better world with greater than he had before. God brought him through this chrysalis, this cocoon, and brought him in to a whole new world. He saw it and experienced it and walked in it. My God, folks, if you want to know what the revelation of Christ is, that's the revelation of Christ. Now, yes, it begins before that. Yes, there is a revelation of the cross in relationship to death of the old man. Yes, there's the need, you know, all of that. But I'm telling you, the high end of the revelation of Christ is not the revelation of what he did on the cross. It's the revelation of who he is now and who we are in union with him. And union with him is a good thing. It's a God thing. Union, just being stuck in ourselves is miserable and hopeless. I could say a few other words I was thinking, but the death of the flesh is not the true death as we see it and comprehend it in the ark. The death of the flesh is not bad, but actually strengthens us. We are encouraged to put to death the deeds of the flesh, not the deeds of Adam, but the demands of our body. Did you know your body has its own demands and stuff like that? You know, I mean, just the flesh. It says, you know, I remember a story once where a guy, he'd been praying for months. He said, "Randy, I'm just praying. I want the Lord to show me a certain thing." And he told me what it was. And about 2 months after he told me that, God revealed that to me, and I was going to share it Sunday morning. And he was in the service, and I was getting ready to share it, and he got up and went out to smoke a cigarette. Came back in after I was done. You know why he got up? His body went, "I want a cigarette. Get up, take me out the door, and feed me." That's his body, his flesh body. So I need it now. We ain't sitting here any longer. And it takes you right out of what the Lord has for you, because we're more controlled by our bodies than we are by the life of Christ within us. All right, let's see. Let me just make sure here, because I wrote one statement, and it's talking about faith, and we say faith for healing and faith for all these things, but the biggest faith of all, obviously, is faith in Christ, but faith in grace. Because my goodness, when you become hopeless, faith in grace is like a giant of a wonderful being that has lifted you out of something that you don't deserve. I mean, that you do deserve that, but you don't deserve to be lifted out of it. Faith in his grace, faith that he really is merciful, faith that he really does reach down for us, as it were. You know, I'm using terminology here, but that's not important. That teaching right there sounds like you're just saying words unless you're in that situation, and then you're just, if you've just come through it, you're just going, "I am so thankful for this gracious heart that my Jesus has and how he loves us." And then I'd mentioned that the altar, and I'll close with this, that the altar settled something where God could say, "Now, no more curse." Remember when we read that? Once the altar was done, he smelled the sweet savor, and then he went, "No more curse." Remember that? So I wrote, in Genesis 15, Abraham wanted to know the surety of the promise God had just made him. God said in Genesis 15, you know, "I'm going to give you a seed." You know, he's going to be the one. He's going to be the heir of all this. Because Abram was sort of complaining, saying, "Well, how shall I know? And how am I going to know that I've got this?" And you know, we go through that, you know. "Well, how do I know you're going to do this and that and whatever?" And so Abram wanted to know the surety of the promise that God had just made to him. God's answer? Sacrifice. He did a sacrifice right there, and all the promises are based on the cross. That is the surety of it. That cross has made it sure. And now it's not just a promise in the air. See, when we talk about the promises of God, we get a little confused because we relate it to our understanding of somebody promising us something. And they can promise you something based on just a whim, just the wind blowing, just a, you know, "Oh, I promise you that, da 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 da." And we all do that. That's human. God promises based on sacrifice. God promises based on the cross. God promises based on something that is sure and immovable and won't change, because he settled it with the cross, and he promises it with his heart based on what is done. But we go, well, you know, and that's what Abraham did. Well, how shall I know this? How am I going to know for sure what you're promising is going to come to pass? Just get out of the way, makes an altar, makes a dividing of birds and all this. A lantern passes through it, the fire of God. Now you know. He's basically saying, this is how I know. Now this is how you need to know. This is established and sure and settled. And so quit freaking out. Quit freaking out. And hold on to the cross, because that's what made me be able to promise. You are dead. You are raised. You are one with Christ. You are seated in heavenly places, not just with him up there, seated with him in heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. God views you that way. He does not change his view because of the altar. We need to quit changing our view based on circumstances or whims or things that seem to, well, that seems contrary. He said these words, now he says these words. These seem to contradict these. Go to the cross and you'll find the answer to both sets of words. And it's settled. All right, we're going to stop right there. Next class, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit as the prism, not prison, prism, and the rainbow. And what all that relates to. Father, we thank you for the presence of the Spirit of God who wants to break us free from our fears and our chains and our beasts and wants to establish us in something that will survive, endure, and overcome all the things of this world that try to rob us of your reality. But you mean business. You meant it with Noah, and you brought him through the process, and you're bringing us through that process into your fullness. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. We're dismissed.